Hello, and welcome to St. John Nepomucene celebration of the Mass for the fourth Sunday in Ordinary Time. This Mass will be celebrated by our pastor, Father Joe Schlafer. Our lector is Sister Maureen, and we are your music ministers, Joyful Sound. Please join in praying our opening hymn, The Feast Meant for Everyone.
Thank you. Let us pray. Grant us, Lord our God, that we may honor you with all our mind and love everyone in truth of heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I dedicated you. A prophet to the nations, I appointed you. But do you gird your loins, stand up and tell them all that I command you? Be not crushed on their account, as though I would leave you crushed before them. For it is I this day who have made you a fortified city, a pillar of iron, a wall of brass against the whole land, against Judah's kings and princes, against its priests and people. They will fight against you, but not prevail over you. For I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Just rescue me.
Brothers and sisters, love is patient. Love is kind. It is not inflated. It is not rude. It does not seek its own interests. It is not quick-tempered. It does not brood over injury. It does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices with truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. If there are prophecies, they will be brought to nothing. If tongues, they will cease. If knowledge, it will be brought to nothing. For we know partially, and we prophesy partially. But when the perfect comes, the partial will be passed away. When I was a child, I used to talk as a child, think as a child, reason as a child. When I became a man, I put aside childish things. At present, we see indistinctly as in a mirror, but then face to face. At present, I know partially, then I shall know fully, as I am fully known. So faith, hope, love remain, these three. But the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Jesus began speaking in the synagogue, saying, "Today this scripture passage is fulfilled in your hearing." And all spoke highly of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They also asked, "Isn't this the son of Joseph?" Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote me this proverb, 'Physician, cure yourself,' and say, 'Do here in your native place the things that we heard were done in Capernaum.'" And Jesus said, "Amen, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own native place. Indeed, I tell you, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the sky was closed for 3.5 years, and a severe famine spread over the entire land. It was to none of these that Elijah was sent, but only to a widow in Zarephath in the land of Sidon. Again, there were many lepers in Israel during the time of Elisha the prophet. Yet not one of them was cleansed, but only Naaman the Syrian. When the people in the synagogue heard this, they were all filled with fury. They rose up, drove Jesus out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town had been built, to hurl him down headlong. But Jesus passed through their midst and went away. The Gospel of the Lord.
I'd like to invite everybody to use their imagination for a moment and to imagine how you would react to Jesus if you lived in first century Nazareth centuries ago, or even if you lived in the town itself where he grew up, or in the region of Galilee. What would you have thought of Jesus? And perhaps I could add a question to that one, and I'd say, would your answer to the first question depend on how you had experienced Jesus? In other words, if you had been part of those thousands of people on the hillside who were very, very hungry after they listened to him for so long, and he multiplied the loaves and the fish and you ate to your fill, would you think of Jesus primarily as a man of great compassion who could feel the needs of the people he was looking at and respond to the needs? Or, if you had seen Jesus give sight to a blind person or cleanse a leper, would you think of Jesus as a kind of hero who could perform miraculous works of love? Or, if you saw how often Jesus said to people, your sins are completely forgiven, would that make you think of Jesus as just a messenger of mercy from God? How about another possibility? If you listened to Jesus when he spoke his parables and taught as often as he did, would he engage your mind and your heart, make you interested in him? Would you think of Jesus as a man of great knowledge and wisdom? That seems to be the case with the people in Nazareth, in the synagogue in today's gospel. Did you hear that beautiful line as they listened to him? The gospel said, all spoke highly of him, and they were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. Now, in all of these little scenarios I've suggested, you might think of Jesus as a great provider, as a healer, as an instrument of forgiveness, a messenger of mercy, or a wise teacher. And I suppose all of these titles have been used to describe Jesus. But there's one other word that Jesus applies to himself in today's gospel, and it's not nearly as positive or as comforting as those other titles that I just mentioned. In today's gospel, Jesus refers to himself as a prophet. And that particular title, as I say, is not as attractive and appealing as all those other things. In fact, in today's gospel, when Jesus spoke as a prophet, it made the people of Nazareth want to kill him. I mean, isn't that an amazing shift in one gospel passage? They spoke highly of him, and by the end of the gospel, they wanted to throw him off a cliff. That's because as he spoke to them, he spoke as a prophet. Now, in the tradition that Jesus came from, a prophet was always someone who challenged people. And in the gospel today, there's a particular kind of challenge that he gives to the people of Nazareth. He kind of is telling them that they should not think of themselves as somehow being more favored by God than other nationalities or other people. Jesus' message was that the God of Israel was here to love and to save all people. His message was that the true God intends to feed the hungers of everybody and heal the hurts of the whole world, the whole human family. And to expand your notion of God is what he was challenging the people in the synagogue to do. And their reaction was very negative. It was too much for them, this challenge of the prophet Jesus. Remember, he called himself a prophet in the gospel. And so their reaction was to drive him out of town and to go to a cliff and to try to throw him over the cliff to get rid of him. But that's what prophets do. They challenge us to expand how we think, how we act, how we understand God. Prophets are people who tell us that no matter how close we are to God, there's always another step to take. Here's how one scripture scholar I was reading described a prophet. Prophets make demands upon us, demands we don't want to hear. They invite us to experience the uncomfortable miracle of change, of conversion. Prophets invite us to hear more truth than we want to hear, to live with more generosity than we thought we would ever need. And that was how Jesus was a prophet. Given that, I'd like to ask you to think about this question. Who are the prophets in our time? And I'd like to suggest a couple of answers. A prophet of our time would be someone like Dorothy Day. She's a woman who has been publicly acclaimed by both Pope Benedict and Pope Francis. They've said Dorothy Day is an example of how to journey towards faith in a secularized society. Pope Francis said she's an exemplary American who built a better future. And why do the Pope say this about Dorothy Day? Because she was so radically dedicated to the needs of the poor. And she was also radically dedicated to nonviolence. Another prophet of our time might be Martin Luther King. His birthday is a national holiday. Again, similar to Dorothy Day, he believed that all conflicts can only be solved by peace and nonviolent action. I think another prophet of our time is Pope Francis. He wrote that beautiful encyclical years ago about how we have to look at the environment we live in, to look at the resources that the world has, the creation of God, and we have to respect it much more than we have been doing. That's a challenge. That's what prophets do. They challenge us. Pope Francis has challenged us to protect the environment and the resources of God's love. I guess I'd say that prophets are willing to take on controversial and unpopular causes and issues. We may agree with what they say, and we may disagree with all or part of their message. But I think what we have to do, or we have to learn from today's gospel, is to avoid the mistake that the people of Nazareth made. And their mistake was that because Jesus challenged them, invited them to think in a broader way, maybe invited them to let go of their preconceived notions of God, they got so angry, they wanted to do away with him. Maybe the gospel is simply suggesting to us that we need to be open to the Holy Spirit, who's always guiding us forward. The Spirit has the task of helping us to know what Jesus wants of us. Yes, Jesus is about comfort. I mentioned those things in the beginning. Healer, teacher, miracle worker, mission, or messenger of mercy. Yes, that's all about comfort. But Jesus also challenges. And I think today's gospel is telling us to accept the challenge, be willing to grow, to expand, not only the way you think, but the way you act, to reach out in new ways. You know, when I say who are the prophets of our times, I mention those people I just mentioned, but sometimes somebody in your own life can be in the role of prophet. Could be a husband or a wife, a mother or a father, a son or a daughter. Could challenge us. And rather than getting angry because someone invites us to think differently or to move in a different direction, let's be people open to the Spirit who reflect on the challenge, who consider whether or not God is calling us to take a step forward. And in that sense, prophets are not people who need to be rejected as they were so often rejected in the history of the Old Testament. They are people whose challenge can lead us to greater insight on how we can put the love of God into practice every day.
And let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God's comfort and God's challenge go beyond all of our hopes and dreams. With confidence, knowing that the Lord cares for our every need, we bring our prayers before him. Our response is, Lord Jesus, hear us. For church leaders, may the Holy Spirit continue to guide and inspire them and keep them faithful to Christ and his gospel message. We pray to the Lord. Lord Jesus, hear us. For all government and civic leaders, may the Lord bless them with wisdom and understanding as they provide for the needs of all people, especially the people they have been elected to serve. We pray to the Lord. Lord Jesus, hear us. That our respect and protection for all human life, from the unborn to the very last stages of life, may grow stronger in the hearts of all people and in our culture and society. We pray to the Lord. Lord Jesus, hear us. For those who are sick and who have asked our prayers, for all those suffering from the coronavirus and any kind of chronic illness or addiction, and for the sick, whose names we now mention aloud. That they may receive strength and healing from God, we pray to the Lord. Lord Jesus, hear us. for all those in the medical profession, for those who care for the sick, for those who are working for the distribution of the vaccines, for first responders, and the heroes in our midst, that their efforts may result in greater health and well-being for all people, we pray to the Lord. Lord Jesus, hear us. For those who have died, especially Alfred Williams, Alfred Eusanio, Thomas Lee, Matilda Massa, for the peace officers in New York City who recently lost their lives, and for all of the deceased whose names we now mention aloud. That God will welcome them into the fullness of life in his kingdom, we pray to the Lord. Lord Jesus, hear us. For the people of our parish and the people of every Christian community, we pray to the Lord. Lord Jesus, hear us. Heavenly Father, ever faithful to your promises, we know that you desire to provide for all your people. Hear our prayers today, which we offer through Christ our Lord.
Oh,
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts of bread and wine, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and John our Bishop, all the clergy, and all of your beloved people. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have gone to their rest in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her husband, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through Christ, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days,
that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
My friends, the peace of the risen Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of the Lord's peace. May the blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life. Amen. Thank you. Nourished by these redeeming gifts, we pray, O Lord, that through this help to eternal salvation, true faith may ever increase in our hearts and in our world. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Just before we conclude, I want to make a comment, and that is that as we are shooting this video mass today, there are a lot of predictions of a very big snowfall coming our way. By the time you look at this mass, that snow may have fallen. And if it has, I hope wherever you are warm, dry, and safe. And it reminds me that it's a great gift to have this video mass, to be in touch with you, our parishioners, and friends of the parish, no matter where you live. And again, in that spirit, we thank you for tuning in to pray with us. We thank Ray Foster, who is here week after week shooting the mass, and of course, our wonderful music ministry, our lector. It's a reminder also that we need to continue to pray that this pandemic is something that passes, especially for people who are sick, that they're restored to health, that those who have lost someone through the pandemic may be consoled by the truth of the resurrection, and most of all, to pray that one day we can be together again in this sacred space, which is so precious to our parish. We pray that, as much as we're delighted that you can pray with us on video, that soon we can come together, all of us, as a parish family, reunite, as it were, and receive strength from each other just by being here together, the strength we need from our Lord to go out into the world and be his disciples. We hope to see you soon again. My friends, the Lord be with you. May Almighty God always bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us go in peace to glorify the Lord by our lives. Thanks be to God.